morning. It is so wonderful to have all of you here with us today. Thank y'all for braving the rainy weather and coming and joining us here so we could come and we can celebrate our wonderful God, our wonderful Savior, Jesus Christ, together this morning. I'm Rhett Carson, the pastor here at Pinecrest, and we welcome you to our service today. We welcome those who are worshiping with us in person. We welcome those who are worshiping us with us online. We're so thankful that you are here today. On that note, you'll see in the pew in front of you, and then also online, you'll see a QR code. We'd love to know that you, get to know a little bit more about you if you're worshiping with us, and also know how to help you as a church body. So please use this Connect card to sign up. Tell us how to contact you. Tell us how we can be of help and service to you as a church. And then also members, if you're not receiving communications, phone calls, and emails from the church, please fill this out. And if you have prayer requests, members and guests, please fill that out. We'd love to be praying for you as a church body as well. A few announcements as we get started today. This coming Wednesday is the first Wednesday of the month, the first Wednesday of May, May the 3rd. And so please come and join us for our monthly first Wednesday cover dish dinner and program. So show up at 5:30, bring some food, a meat, a side dish, a dessert, a salad to share. And then at 6 o'clock, we're going to have a program. I'm delighted that Chip Scher, president of Bon Clark and also a member of our church, will be here, and he'll be able to tell us about the important ministry of Bon Clark and that happens just down the road from us. Every ARP church member has to drive all the way to Flat Rock to benefit from Bon Clark, and we have it just down the road. It does an important ministry. Come and find out more about who they are and what they do and how they are a blessing to so many people in our community and in our nation. Join us this coming Wednesday. Also, this coming Saturday, I wanted to let you know we have May 6th. We do have two funerals that are happening on the same day, so I just want to clarify that for you. At 1 o'clock is Michael McCall's service. That one is private. The family said we want to keep that family only, but at 3 p.m. we have Jim Hart's service, and that is one that we would love for you to come to, the family would love for you to come to, so please plan to come to that. On that note, because we have two services, I've sent an email about this, but maybe you don't get email. The family has asked for privacy during the Michael McCall service, so if you are coming to Jim Hart's service even to help, please wait till 1:30. If you want to come during the week and do things, that's fine, but on Saturday, please wait till 1:30 to come to the church so that we can give the family the privacy they need. But then please come and help us as we get ready for Jim Hart's service and for its reception. On that note, I do want to say, Lord willing, y'all might not know this. Jim Hart put so many hours into getting this picnic shelter built behind us. At this moment, the only thing left to happen is to put an electrician to come this week and put the ceiling fans in and to put the light fixtures in. And it will be ready. And how fitting and appropriate will be if the first thing we do use in that picnic shelter is to hold a reception and celebration of Jim Hart's life. And so we're planning on that, hoping that, pray that would happen. But that's the plan. Please come us and help us to celebrate Jim and, more importantly, his Savior this coming Saturday at 3 p.m. Also wanted to mention to you the farmer's market. The farmer's market does plan to meet for the first time this spring, this coming Thursday, from 3 to 6. So come enjoy a wonderful variety of farm-grown foods and other crafts that they have made in the area and meet some wonderful folks and introduce them to Jesus Christ, hopefully. But we have held off on our kickoff event until Thursday, May 11th. We just decided we had too much going on in our church family this week. We're pushing that back a week. So May 11th is our next outreach project where we're going to have blow-up games, snow cones, and invite the community to come and join us at the farmer's market. If you can help with that or just show up at that, we would appreciate your help. Talk to Mike Hicks, talk to Morris Bird if you need more details about those events. At this time, I'm going to call Mark Kennedy forward. There he is. Mark, if you come forward and help make an announcement for us today, I'd appreciate it. Mark has an announcement on behalf of the worship committee and on behalf of the session.
Thank you. Good morning. I am delighted to bring you a special announcement. The worship committee and the session have approved of a part-time job description for a worship music coordinator for Pinecrest. The position is designed basically around the responsibilities that and duties that Evan Carson has been filling for the past few weeks and even months. So at this time, from now until Evan's transition to college approximately July 31st. Evan Carson will be our part-time worship music coordinator. So thank you. Please give your thanks to Evan personally after the service. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Appreciate that. Evan, we appreciate all that you have done for the church. That Tariana's excited, so Tariana says congratulations as well. We're so thankful. At this time, I do have another special announcement, but we're going to wait and do that in the middle of our service in just a few moments. I'll bring your attention to that. But at this time, let's prepare ourselves for worship. Perhaps you need to have a conversation with God. Perhaps there are some sins you need to confess and seek His forgiveness again. Perhaps there are some things that you need to bring before Him and just cast your burdens onto Him at this time. But let's prepare ourselves for worship as we listen in silence to this morning's prelude. Amen. Thank you, Judy. Do also want to say, we just thanked Evan. I just want to let y'all know, we are blessed to have Judy Roberts, Frederick, playing our piano each and every week. Not every church has somebody as talented and dedicated. So, Judy, thank you for all you do and continue to do for our worship ministry here at Pinecrest. It is a blessing to me and many others. As we turn now to worship the Lord at this time, I'm going to turn us to not normally the place where I turn to call to worship. Usually I'm in the Psalms, but I'm going to invite you to come into the major prophet of Ezekiel with me today. Two of my favorite Old Testament passages come from Ezekiel. Ezekiel chapter 36 and 37. I read 37 a few months ago talking about the Valley of the Dry Bones and how God brings life to those dry bones. But in Ezekiel chapter 36, we have the beautiful language of a heart that is made of stone until God intervenes and makes it flesh and comes to life. Ezekiel chapter 36, verses 22 through 28. Therefore, say to the house of Israel, thus says the Lord God, it is not for your sake, O house of Israel, that I am about to act, but for the sake of my holy name, which you have profaned among the nations to which you came. And I will vindicate the holiness of my great name, which has been profaned among the nations, and which you have profaned among them. And the nations will know that I am the Lord, declares the Lord God, when through you I vindicate my holiness before their eyes. I will take you from the nations and gather you from all countries and bring you into your own land. I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean. From all your uncleanliness and from all your idols I will cleanse you, and I will give you a new heart. And a new spirit I will put within you, and I'll remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules. You shall dwell in the land that I give to your fathers, and you shall be my people, and I will be your God. I begin us with that because we are going to be talking about the Holy Spirit in our sermon today, but also we're going to be observing the sacrament of baptism today. And it's a great and wonderful reminder of what God does, how he intervenes and takes us in all of our filth and all of our distractions, and he chooses us as ourselves, and he cleanses us. Not because we deserve it, but in spite of what we deserve. He chooses us. He cleanses us, and he calls us as his own. And yes, we're going to be celebrating the sacrament of baptism for Ryan today. But if you have professed faith in Jesus Christ, I want you to know that God's Spirit rests upon you, and you have been cleansed. God, the Holy God, has claimed you as his own. Oh, brothers and sisters, we have so much to be thankful for today and so much to praise. God has chosen us, he has cleansed us, and he has placed his Spirit upon us. Come. Let us worship and praise and look to God again today. Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this opportunity to come and to worship you in spirit and in truth. We thank you, Lord, that you did not cast us out and cast us away, even though that's, Lord, all we deserve because of our rebellion, because of our filth, because of our false idols and how we had profaned you. But, oh Lord, you still chose to love us. You still chose to intervene. You chose to cleanse us. You chose to call us by name, to make us your own, and to be our God. And, oh Father, we thank you. We thank you for how you've shown this to us in many ways, but especially by sending Jesus Christ to die in our place. Oh Lord, now help us come to you in the newness of life that you bring and give you praise and give you adoration for who you are. All that you have done, all that you are doing and will do for us, your people. Help us, Lord, to worship you in spirit and truth, we pray, in the great name of Jesus Christ. Oh, Father, we pray in the name of Jesus, but we also pray as he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, at this time we're going to affirm what Scripture teaches us in a summary fashion by reciting a creed, one of the original creeds, the Nicene Creed, together. Brothers and sisters, what do you believe that Scripture teaches us? I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen and amen. Brothers and sisters, at this time we're going to have a sacrament of baptism. So this time I want to invite Ryan to come forward. I call him Ryan W., and he's going to help you know how to say his name here in a second. All right? I always butcher it. But Ryan, come forward. Mark, if you'd come and join us up front as well. First of all, I just want to delight to say it was just before the service today. Ryan came and he met with our elders today at a called session meeting. He professed his faith in Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. He answered in the affirmative the vows of church membership, and he was accepted as a new member of Pinecrest Church. So, Ryan, welcome to our church body. Ryan is here with several members of his family. They live just down the mountain from us in Saluda. Ryan is a major in the Army, so it's very good to have him. He'll explain a little bit about his job to you if you come and ask him about that. But he helps with the Army Reserve and oversees many of the operations that they do. He's in active service with the Reserves. Did I say that? Okay, all right, good, close enough. All right, but he's been delighted. He's been worshiping with us, started many years ago because his mother, Ann Gosnell, is a member of Pinecrest Church. So Ryan's often been here with her. It's been a joy getting to know Ryan over the past few years. Things have settled down for him a little bit, and he's been able to attend Pinecrest with us regularly. And so it is my delight now that he's come before church membership. One thing I want to let you know, too, is that Ryan did profess faith in Jesus Christ many years ago, but he's never publicly professed that and joined a church. So as part of his joining the church, because he was not baptized as an infant, we are going to have an adult baptism at this time. Let me take a moment and just explain some things to you. You know, give me a minute, I'll take an hour. And I want to just explain some things to you about why are we doing a baptism today. First of all, I want to say is many people say you're Presbyterian, you don't believe in believer's baptism. That is actually a lie. That's false. We absolutely believe in believer's baptism in the Presbyterian Church. Everyone who professes faith in Jesus Christ should be baptized. Why? Because the Bible tells us so. Jesus Christ told us to baptize people that profess faith in him. The only difference is, as Presbyterians, we also believe in infant baptism, that God makes covenants with the children, and we should go ahead and put the sign and the seal upon them because of their parents' faith, they are members of Christ's bride, the church. But we're here to do adult baptism today, so let me explain that to you just for a second. I've already had this conversation with Ryan, but I want to have it with you guys because you need to know what baptism is all about. It is a sacrament of the church. What does that mean? It means it is a sign and seal of the covenant of grace. What does that mean? It means that baptism shows and reminds us and seals us to all the promises of Jesus Christ and what he did for us if we by faith receive it. So baptism is a sign and a seal that uses water. And you can really understand baptism if you remember the significance of water. What does water do? Water brings life. And so we are celebrating this day as we baptized Ryan that God's Holy Spirit through Jesus Christ has brought new life to him. He is spiritually alive because of the work that Christ has done for him and that he is acknowledged by professing faith in him. What does water do? Water cleanses. We celebrate on this day that because of his faith in Jesus Christ and because of what Jesus Christ did for Ryan on the cross, that he is cleansed of his sins. He is justified in the sight of God. And one day all sins and all the effects of the fall will be completely removed from Ryan. Water also, and this kind of more associates with the oil in the Old Testament, but they would pour oil on people's heads. Remember that? Why did they do that? To anoint them. To anoint the prophets, to anoint the priests, to anoint the king, and say, you have been set apart. Baptism sets us apart. Ryan is set apart. He is now a member of Christ's bride, the church. Christ has claimed Ryan and says, he is mine. Not the devil's, not the world's, not even Ryan's. He belongs now and forevermore in the sight of God to Jesus Christ. He is his. That is what Ryan's baptism does, the signs and seals, and it is ours as well if we have been baptized and profess faith in Jesus Christ. We have new life. We've been cleansed. We are Christ now and forevermore. Pray with me. Heavenly Father, we come to you today, Lord, and we are so excited, Father, that you have come and you have told us to go out into all the world, teaching them your commandments and baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Baptism is now the covenant sign that you have given to your church that represents Jesus Christ and all that he has done and is doing for his people. And, oh, Lord, we thank you that Ryan knows Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. And we pray, Lord, that as we come together, that your Spirit will continue to be his work, that this baptism, this water would truly be a sign and seal to Ryan of all that you have done through him for Jesus Christ, and that, Lord, he would be sealed and be yours for all of eternity. Oh, Lord, we lift up this time. We lift up this sacrament. We lift up this time together and these blessings in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Ryan, if you'd please kneel. Oh, Ryan, I forgot to tell you this earlier. Say your last name for me.
Weersbicky.
All right. Hopefully I can remember that in 3 seconds. Ryan Weersbicky, I baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. May God's blessings rest upon you both now and for all of eternity. Amen. Please rise. Brothers and sisters, Ryan has now received the covenant sign and seal of baptism. He is now our brother in the faith and our brother here at Pinecrest Church. Ryan, we welcome you to our fellowship. We pray that all the blessings and the resources of the church would be yours. You have a now spiritual family here at Pinecrest. And we pray that you would also come and be a blessing to us and encourage us in our faith as well as a member of that body too. Welcome to our service. Welcome to our fellowship. Welcome to the body of Christ.
Thank you.
Love you, brother. All right. You can now go sit next to your wonderful earthly family. And at the end of the service, I have asked Ryan to come out and join me out front so that you can welcome him and welcome him into the body of Christ here at Pinecrest. Well, who feels like singing? We have a God to praise. Come, let's worship the God through song. You're going to notice in this song, we're going to worship every person of the Godhead, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I invite you to sing with me hymn number 267. If you're able, please stand. You can use the green hymn books, or the words will be appearing on the screen.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Our first scripture reading this morning is actually going to come from the Gospel of John. We are actually in John chapter 16, but I have to do some painful things as a pastor. I have to skip over passages entirely so that we can kind of meet a timeline, but also I skip over passages sometimes intentionally so I can come back to them. Jesus Christ is in the upper room, and he is talking to the disciples about what comes next. He's both preparing them for his incoming, right around the corner in just a few hours, arrest, betrayal, crucifixion, death, and then later resurrection. But he is also preparing the disciples for what is to come after he ascends to heaven, and they are now the leaders of his bride, the church. And he tells them that they are not going to be on their own. Even when he goes to heaven, he is going to send a helper, a comforter, an advocate, in the Greek, a paraclete, the Holy Spirit, the third person of God, to come and be with him. And he describes the Holy Spirit throughout this time in the upper room. The two main sections which we'll read this morning is John chapter 14, verses 12 through 31. And in just a few minutes, I'll also read John chapter 16, verses 5 through 15. So hear now the reading of God's holy word, John chapter 14, verses 12 through 31. Truly, truly, I say to you, this is Jesus speaking, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do, and greater works than these will he do, because I am going to the Father. Whatever you ask in my name, this I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you yet a little while, and the world will see me no more. But you will see me because I live. You also will live. In that day you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. Whoever has my commandments and keeps them, he it is who loves me, and he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, Lord, how is it that you will manifest yourself to us and not to the world? Jesus answered him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and he will come to him and make our home with him. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words, and the word that you hear is not mine, but the Father's who sent me. These things I have spoken to you while I am still with you. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. You heard me say to you, I am going away and I will come to you. If you loved me, you would have rejoiced, because I am going to the Father, for the Father is greater than I. And now I have told you before it takes place, so that when it does take place, you may believe. I will no longer talk much with you, for the ruler of the world is coming. He has no claim on me, but I do as the Father has commanded me, so that the world may know that I love the Father. Rise, let us go from here. This is God's word. This time I want to come before the Lord in prayer with you. We're going to have a time of corporate prayer. I don't have time to mention all the prayer requests I know of, but please make sure you are receiving the emails from Pinecrest so that you can be praying for our church brothers and sisters and the concerns that weigh upon them. I do have two wonderful pieces of great news for you today. Kathy Wilson, one of the ARP pastor wives that often worships with us, has finished her chemotherapy, and she went and met with the doctor, and they said radiation is not necessary. So praise the Lord. We think the cancer is gone, has been dealt with, and she is able to end her cancer treatment. So please rejoice with God with us. Also, I want to just give a praise, but also a prayer request. Dottie Kent had a successful surgery on Monday to deal with her sciatica, so we are praying and optimistic that this pain and this difficulty is behind her and that she will recover from surgery well. Do pray for her. She may not be able to attend church because she'll be on a walker for a few weeks here, but do continue to pray for Dottie Kent and praise God for the successful surgery. Then also, many of y'all will know Ruth Jones, who worshiped with us for many years before moving to her family down in Florida. Ruth took a tumble a few weeks ago and fractured her vertebrae. So please be in prayer for Ruth Jones, and please be in prayer for her healing during this time as well. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come on this day delighted, Lord, at the opportunity to come and worship you. Delighted at the opportunity to come and to be able to confess to you our sins and our failures and know that, Lord, we are saved not because of our successes and our worthiness, but in spite of them. And, oh, Lord, you have promised that even if we continue to stumble and continue to fall and fall short, Lord, that you are good and faithful to forgive us and to treat us in grace and mercy. So, Father, we come, we confess our sins and our failings this very week. And we delight to know that when we do confess those and turn to Christ in faith, as we repent and, oh Lord, say that we no longer want to pursue these sins, but pursue you and pursue righteousness, that you are promised to be faithful and just to forgive our sins and remove them from us as far as the east is from the west. Thank you, Lord, for this and for this reminder and this forgiveness that is ours in Jesus Christ. But, oh Lord, we also thank you that you are continuing to work, oh Lord, in us in this world and so many other beautiful ways. Oh Lord, it's so easy to get distracted by all the hardships and difficulties in this life, but truly, Lord, we are blessed beyond all measure to know a loving Heavenly Father is watching over us, to know, Lord, that you are giving us and supplying us everything that we need in this life. And so, Father, we do pause and we thank you. We thank you, Lord, for those worldly needs that you meet by supplying us with our daily bread. We thank you, Lord, that we are not on our own, but have your Holy Spirit, your word. We have the church, and we have the families you've blessed us with and the friends. And, Father, we thank you for those gifts as well. Oh, Lord, we come and we do lift you up as we have prayed to you and asked for your will to be done and lifted up our needs and concerns that you, Lord, have once again acted in mercy and in grace. Oh, Father, we praise you on this day that Kathy Wilson is done with her cancer treatments. Oh, Lord, we praise you that Dottie Kent had a successful surgery. Oh, Lord, we praise you that the prayers that Ann Gosnell had for her son, Ryan, Lord, have been answered, and you have been faithful to Ryan, and, oh, Lord, brought him to faith in Jesus Christ and allowed him to become a member of his church. Oh, Lord, we praise you for your goodness to us and the many other requests. Oh, Lord, as we come together today, we do continue to lift up our needs to you. For, Father, we know we are not on our own, but you delight to hear our needs and to lift them up to you, Lord, and to know that you hear them and that you will answer according to your love and your perfect plan. Oh, Father, we pray for this world as we see it suffering from afflictions, both man-made and natural, because of the fall. Oh, Lord, bring grace and bring healing and bring life and bring restoration and rescue where it is needed. Oh, Lord, we cry out for the United States of America and pray your guidance and blessing upon this land. Oh, Lord, may you heal divides. Oh, Lord, may you allow justice to reign. Oh, Lord, would you allow us to show mercy to one another? Oh, Lord, would you allow us to treat people with respect and as being made in the image of God? Oh, Lord, would you allow this country to be one that proclaims what is good to be good and what is evil to be evil and does not mix the two? Oh, Lord, would you come and would you be with us and allow your church to not be something that just meets once a week in a social club, but to be the salt and light of the earth, to spread and to show and demonstrate the love and the grace and the mercy of God in our lives and how we treat one another. Oh, Lord, we come and we cry out to missionaries that are around the world. May you watch over and protect them and keep them safe and bless their ministry and allow your church to grow over all the world. And may you also be faithful here in America and allow your church to grow and to flourish, oh, Lord. People proclaim that the church is dead, it is behind us. But, oh, Lord, we do not need to believe that to be true. For, Father, if you are at work, all things are possible. So, Lord, spread the gospel. Spread the good news. Spread the joy of salvation. And, oh, Lord, may you use us in this room to spread it. Make us your instruments, we pray. Oh, Lord, we do lift up the other people dealing with other hardships, financial, mental, relational, Father, spiritual, and we cry out to you for them. We also specifically cry out to those experiencing physical hardships at this time. May you please continue to heal Dottie Kent. May you continue to be with those who are dealing with cancer treatments themselves, even those members of our own body. May you continue to be with those who have had surgeries or about to have surgeries and heal them completely. May you be with those that have taken falls and heal them. We especially lift up to you Ruth Jones at this time and Kim Shelton. And, oh, Lord, we come and we cry out to you and pray that whatever the needs are that are being lifted up to you at this time, whether I know them, whether they're on our prayer list or not, would you remind those that are praying with me that you hear those requests, that you love them, and that you stand ready to act in mercy and in power in their lives. Oh, Lord, remind us that we are never on our own. We have a great and a wonderful helper. We have the triune God. And, Father, we pray and thank you for your love, for answered prayers, and the prayers you will answer in the future out of your love and mercy. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. So we continue to worship the Lord. Oh, and I am in trouble. I got a long sermon today. It's already 10:35. All right, guys, just brace yourself. We got some wonderful snacks after the service, okay? If you can hold out for a little bit longer, we're going to get to them, I promise. But now we're going to read our second scripture passage. Once again, we're in the Gospel of John. What is a gospel? It is a biography of Jesus Christ, which reveals to us why Jesus Christ is gospel, which literally means good news. Why is Jesus Christ good news to the world and to you and to me? We're in the gospel according to John, the son of Zebedee, one of the 12 apostles, and he is revealing to us many wonderful truths that are not in the other gospel stories. The truths are there, but he's revealing additional stories about Jesus Christ, additional teachings that are not contained in them. And he really hones in the upper room, as I mentioned just a few minutes ago. And here he is preparing the disciples to know that after he leaves, he is sending someone to help him. He is sending the third person of the Trinity, the Holy Spirit, to be their helper, to be their paraclete, their advocate. Hear now the reading of God's holy word once again, now in John chapter 16, and I'll be reading verses 5 through 15. But now I am going to him who sent me, and none of you asked me, where are you going? But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your heart. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away, for if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you, and when he comes, he will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment concerning sin, because they do not believe in me. Concerning righteousness, because I go to the Father, and you will see me no longer. Concerning judgment, because the ruler of the world is judged. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth, for he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, for he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. Therefore, I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Pray with me once again. Heavenly Father, we come to you today and we do thank you, Lord, for your word. We thank you for the truth it brings, and we pray, Lord, that you would guide us into that truth by your Holy Spirit, our helper, our advocate at this time. Help us to pay attention to it. Help us to understand it. Help us to be changed by it. Help us to live according to it, we pray. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. As I read John chapter 14 and John chapter 16, I'm reminded of the story of Goldilocks and the Three Bears. You remember that story? Goldilocks and the Three Bears? Little Goldilocks is wandering through a wood. She finds a bear's house. She walks in, and she goes in, and she tries out, I think, their chairs first, then their porridges, and then their beds, right? You remember that? She sits in the father's chair. It's too hard. So she sits in the mother's bear. It's too soft. Sits in the baby bear's chair, it's just right. Then she goes to the porridge, and the father's porridge is too hot, the mother's is too cold, and the baby's is just right. Why does John chapter 14 and 16, and talking about the Holy Spirit, remind me of Goldilocks and the Three Bears? Now, before you raise your hand and say, I know, Rhett, you're going to be talking about the Trinity today. And that means that the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are the Three Bears. The Father is too hard. The Holy Spirit's too soft, and the Jesus is just right. Well, if that's your understanding of the Trinity, no. That is heresy. If that's your idea, wipe that off the whiteboard, break the whiteboard down, throw it in the dumpster, and set it on fire. Because that will not bring you to an understanding of God Almighty. That is nothing to do with the actual Trinity of God. I bring up the Goldilocks and the three bears not to explain the Trinity to you, but to explain the third person of the Trinity and what I see as the failures of the church to address him correctly. You see, some churches out there are too big and almighty on the Holy Spirit, and they emphasize the role of the Holy Spirit too much to the point where they exclude the Father and the Son. It's all about the Holy Spirit. It's all about the gifts he can bring. It's only about his manifestation upon you that matters, and they forget to talk about God the Father, and they forget to talk about God the Son. But then you have other people on the other extreme, which are more likely to find in good old Presbyterian churches, where we never talk about the Holy Spirit. We talk about the Father, we talk about the Son, we acknowledge the Holy Spirit is there, but if you're there in the midst of the church, if you're listening to the sermons, you would think that God is not Trinitarian, he's binitarian. Because all we talk about is two, Father and Son, and we don't speak about the Holy Spirit and his importance in the world and in the church, in our lives today. So I want to speak to you and say, let's counteract both those extreme tens. Let's throw away the father's hot porridge, and let's throw away the mother's cold porridge, and let's try and get it just right when it comes to the Holy Spirit, that we emphasize him and his works and praise and worship him, but not to the exclusion of the Father and the Son. So let's talk about the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Trinity today. But before I can talk about the Holy Spirit, we got to take a step back and we got to talk about God. First thing I'm going to do today is I'm going to introduce you to some questions and answers from the Westminster Shorter Catechism. In the 1600s, Westminster divines, these leaders in the church all gathered together at Westminster Abbey, and they came together and they discussed all of Scripture, and they made summary questions and answers based on all of Scripture to several important biblical truths. And those are the ones we affirm as a church here at Pinecrest as a correct summary of the teachings of Scripture. And so let's look at those summaries of what it teaches about God. And Kathy's going to put those on the screen. So we're going to start with question number four. Pretty soon, right off the bat, we get to the question, what is God? And the Westminster Divines summarized all of Scripture in this way. They said, God is a spirit, infinite, eternal, and unchangeable in his being, wisdom, power, holiness, justice, goodness, and truth. But then they go on. They say, question number five, are there more gods than one? Answer, according to Scripture, there is but one only, the living and true God. Then they give a little bit more information, though. They say, how many persons are there in the Godhead? The answer, according to Scripture, is that there are three persons in the Godhead, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. We say the Holy Spirit today. Ghost has negative connotations. It's also limited to a certain little area. It's the essence that remains after a body's gone. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about a spirit like God is a spirit who is everywhere. Spirit is more appropriate thing to say in English today. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, and these three are one God, the same in substance, equal in power and glory. That's how the Westminster's divined and summarized the teaching about God in all of Scripture. So what does it reveal to us about God? There's only one God, yet that God is three. And so we use the term, hopefully you've heard it before, Trinity. Heard of that? Trinity? Trinity, are you able to break that word down into two words? You know what it means? Tri, three, unity, united. Three, yet one. That's what you're saying in the Trinity. God is three, yet one. Now I want to right off the bat tell you that's a great mystery. We're human finite beings. We can't comprehend how something can be completely three and one, but we have to affirm the teachings of Scripture that tell us that's the exact case. There is only one God, but in the Godhead we see three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Let me pause right here and tell you that there is a great truth right in that moment that I want to tell you that so many people get wrong about the Holy Spirit. Scripture describes the Holy Spirit as a person. He is not some unknowable force like Star Wars, okay? That's not the Holy Spirit. He is a person that you can know. He is a person that in Scripture decides, that acts, that speaks, that feels, just like a person. The Holy Spirit is a person. He is one of the three persons of the Godhead of the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. As we speak about the Trinity today and about the Holy Spirit, we also need to understand there's two ways to talk about the Trinity. My small group, we talked about this. I probably went too much in depth, so I'm just going to summarize it. There's such a thing called the ontological trinity, and there's such a thing called the economic trinity. If you know that, great. If you know the Greek behind those words, you're going to really understand what I'm about to say. If you don't know the Greek, here's what is going on. There is a trinity of essence. On means being, essence. And that is an affirmation that is scripture. We have three persons of the Godhead, and they are indistinguishable in essence. Just as we just read from the Westminster Confession, each person of the Godhead, including the Holy Spirit, is of the same substance, equal in power and glory. The Holy Spirit is just as much God as God the Father and God the Son, and is indistinguishable in substance. The distinction, and I know I'm going to give a very brief summary to this. There's more to say about the Trinity, but here's going to be my emphasis today. The way we distinguish among the Trinity, primary way we distinguish, is actually the economics, the works that we associate with the persons of the Trinity. It's not a thing that there's a lesser God and a greater God, more God and less God in the Trinity. They are all equally God in substance, but there are works that we associate with different parts of the persons of the Trinity. And so when we distinguish the Holy Spirit from the Father and the Son, we are distinguishing the works that we associate with the Holy Spirit. Let me do pause for a moment and say that the Trinity, the Godhead, is perfectly united in its goals and purposes. But there is a distinction in the works that each part of the Godhead does to accomplish their unified goals and purposes in the world today. So what are the goals and purposes of the Holy Spirit? What are the works that he does in unity with the Father and the Son? I'm going to summarize with one word. It's a gross summary of everything the Holy Spirit, but if you want to understand it in one word, this is the Holy Spirit's work as a God, as part of the Godhead, as part of the Trinity, and it is this: the Holy Spirit applies. If you understand the works of the Holy Spirit as the economic Trinity, as the works that he does in distinction from God the Son and God the Father, the Holy Spirit applies. We're going to talk about that and flush that out. I'm going to use some other words later, but all of those would fall underneath the Holy Spirit applies. So if you want to go back and let's talk about the big category about the covenant of redemption, about God's purposes of redeeming people, of saving people from their sins, we discuss it in this way, or we characterize the works in this way. God the Father appoints. God the Son accomplishes. God the Spirit applies. All of them working in perfect unity together, but distinguishable by their works. God the Father appoints. God the Father chooses people to be saved and redeemed from their sins. And then he sends the Son and the Holy Spirit to bring about their redemption. God the Son, also known as, I hope you know this answer. Do you know who God the Son is? What do we know him by? Jesus Christ. That's who I'm talking about. God the Son accomplishes the redemption of the people that God the Father has chosen. How does he do that? He does that by obeying the Father, submitting to him, perfectly keeping all of his laws, coming to earth, taking on a flesh, and then dying for their sins upon the cross. God the Son, Jesus Christ, accomplishes the redemption of the people. But then it is the Holy Spirit's work to apply that redemption to the people. Think about it this way for a minute with me. Let's talk about those scam emails you get every week. Let's assume that you actually do have that great-great uncle in Eastern Europe, and he really does want to leave you billions of dollars. That's all great and good, but guess what? All those billions of dollars in his account in Eastern Europe isn't going to do you any good unless it's what? Transferred into your account. How do we benefit from Jesus Christ and what he did on the cross 2,000 years ago? It must be transferred to our account. It must be applied to us. The debts that we owe must be transferred to Jesus Christ, and the benefits and the blessing and the forgiveness and the redemption that he accomplished must be applied to us and transferred to our account. It is the role of the Holy Spirit to apply the benefits of Jesus Christ to us. In other words, if the Holy Spirit was not at work, no one would be saved, because no one would have the benefits of Jesus Christ applied to them. I'm not saying it's not necessary. It's absolutely necessary for God the Father to do what he did. It's absolutely necessary for God the Son to do what he did. But it is also necessary for the Holy Spirit to do what he did so that anyone can be saved. If you are saved today, you can praise and thank not just God the Father and the Son, but you need to praise and give thanks to God the Holy Spirit for doing what he has done to bring about your salvation by applying the benefits of Jesus Christ and his redemption to you. The Holy Spirit applies. He is the one that brings the life of Jesus Christ to us and brings all the other benefits of being united to Jesus Christ into our lives. Now, once again, I'm going to have to do a gross summary here. Yes, there's more to say. Perhaps I'm going to speak too much to some people. I'm going to speak too less for others. I'm sorry, but let me try and summarize this as best as I can. He is applying the benefits of Jesus Christ and the benefits of redemption to us. And so when we speak about the Holy Spirit's application, we see his works being brought out and testified to Jesus Christ in the upper room, to the disciples, and to us today. What are the ways that the Holy Spirit applies certain things to us? First of all, we can see throughout Scripture, and especially here in the upper room with Jesus Christ, that the Holy Spirit reveals. That's one of the main works of the Holy Spirit, as he applies the benefits of Christ to us, is that he reveals. I learned in Spanish class at Erskine College that I needed glasses. That was my first time I figured out that I needed glasses. Why? Because the professor was writing all these English words and their translations into Spanish and how to conjugate verbs in Spanish on the board, and I was writing rapidly, but I could never catch up with the professor, who would write the board, stand there for a few minutes, and then erase them, and then start writing again. And the reason was because I couldn't see or understand quickly enough what the words were on the board to write them down. I needed glasses to help me see clearly what the professor had on the board, the truths that were on the board that I needed to know. The Holy Spirit works to reveal the truths of God to his people today. That's one of the Holy Spirit's main jobs, is that he reveals the truth. And that's what Jesus Christ tells the disciple. The Holy Spirit is going to come and reveal my truths to you and help you to understand them. It's also what Jesus Christ is referring to, saying it's going to be a blessing when I leave, because the Holy Spirit's going to come and he's going to reveal my truth to you and to the world. He is going to convict the world of sin. He's going to allow the world to understand for the first time that they are sinners, that they have broken God's law and his commandments, that they stand condemned before God for doing so, and that they can only be saved if God shows him mercy. But God has shown them mercy and offers them forgiveness through Jesus Christ. But they must confess Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior before he comes in judgment. If, brothers and sisters, you realize that to be true, if you've been convicted of your sins and turned to faith in Jesus Christ, that is the role of the Holy Spirit. He has revealed that truth to you. You did not come to that truth on your own. The wisdom of Scripture and the Bible and the path of salvation and the gospel, it is foolishness and it is folly to a world, because they cannot see the truth even though it is right there in front of them. They can't see the truth. They are blind to it. They are dead to it. And even what they can see in Romans chapter 1, they reject and they deny. If anybody understands the truth of the gospel, it is because the Holy Spirit has revealed it to him. And it is why, if you have done so, you know it is wisdom and you know it is life. Because it is true. Because the Spirit has revealed the truth to you. No one has been saved without the work of the Holy Spirit to reveal and convict of the truth of the gospel. But this Holy Spirit also reveals the Word of God to us. It reveals its truth and its meaning and its application in a way that the world can come to the Bible and they will not understand. The Holy Spirit helps us to understand it. I will be the first to confess to you, as I read through the Gospels, I get very frustrated with the disciples. I get frustrated with the disciples because they keep asking Jesus Christ the same question over and over. They keep forgetting that he's told them that he's going to die. They keep forgetting what their job is, and they keep misunderstanding the things that he said. If you are in the same boat as me and you get frustrated with disciples, here's two things you need to do. First of all, you need to remember that you and I are not that much better. We continue and constantly misunderstand and forget what Jesus Christ has clearly told us. But the second thing I want you to understand is what Jesus is telling them in this word. I don't know if you picked that up as we read John 14 and 16. Part of the reasons they kept forgetting and not understanding is because they did not yet have the Holy Spirit that we do today. Because the Holy Spirit now is indwelling us, and he is revealing the truth of God and helping us to see and to remember and understand and be changed by and live according to God's word. He reveals it to us. Praise be to God for the Holy Spirit who helps us to read and understand God's word. In fact, we wouldn't even have God's word if it wasn't for the Holy Spirit. Did you know that? This wasn't just a bunch of writers that got together and said, let me write down some truths. No. We're told in 2 Peter 1, 19 and 20 that no prophecy has its origin in the will of man, but each person who wrote scripture, a book of the Bible, only wrote what they were carried along by the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, to write. The very reason we have scripture is because the Holy Spirit took the truths that God the Father and God the Son gave to him, and he allowed the writers to write them down to bless them and to bless us today. The Holy Spirit gives us God's word. Praise be to God for the Holy Spirit who reveals God's truth to us for salvation and to life. 10:56. Sorry, folks, I got two more points. We're going to be here a while. Buckle up. God, the Holy Spirit, applies. And one of the ways he applies is he comes and he reveals to us. But there's another important thing that we give to the aspect, the works of the Holy Spirit, and that is the Holy Spirit indwells. The Holy Spirit comes and it dwells. It dwells in us and in the people of God. Jesus Christ, the Son, came down to earth and he came and he dwelt among us for a while. He tabernacled, but then he said, I've got to go. I've got to go back and be at my Father's throne, but when I go, you will not be on your own. I will send the Helper, the Holy Spirit, to be with you. And we have the presence of God with us today because the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Trinity, is the Godhead, the person of God, that is now with us. We see that arrival happening on Pentecost Sunday. Remember that? The wind came. The flames of tongue appeared on the people's head. They started speaking in languages they did not know. That was the arrival of the Holy Spirit. And that Holy Spirit continues to come upon each person who has professed faith in Jesus Christ. He comes and he lives in us. In fact, and this might boggle your mind for a moment because it is an affirmation of the truth, but it might confuse you for a second. Jesus Christ promises to be with us to the very end of the age. You know that, right? But it's actually Christ is present with us because his Spirit is with us, the Holy Spirit. Christ in bodily form is currently at the right hand of God the Father. It is his Spirit that comes down and lives and indwells in us. And that is how God is with us. There's an old joke that tells us about the two greatest days of the year. I don't know if you've heard it before. There's the two best days of the year. The first day is the day that family come to visit. The second day is the day they leave. The two best days of the year. It's wonderful to be with family for a while, to enjoy their fellowship, but eventually you get to the point you're like, okay, I've got to get back to my other things. I've got to focus on other things and get back to these things and not be concerned about you. And so we celebrate when they come. We also in some ways celebrate when they leave. But Jesus Christ tells us that when the Holy Spirit comes, he's not going to just come to you and live for a while. He is going to come and he is going to dwell with you forever. And that might cause us some consternation at first. Because it means we can't just say and ignore the Holy Spirit at some time. We can't say, hurry up, Holy Spirit, and leave. I want to get back to my old life and my old ways. I want to start being able to ignore God's word and go back to my sins. But we can't do that because the Holy Spirit, we're told, is with us. And if we can do it, we shouldn't do it. Because we will grieve the Holy Spirit who is within us. We are not our own. We've been bought with a price, and we are now the temple of God. God's Spirit is dwelling within us, and we cannot involve God in our sin. And the Holy Spirit is here to say. It might cause us some consternation, but it's a beautiful thing because those things that you are craving in the world, they do not offer peace. They do not offer satisfaction. They do not offer fulfillment. They will only drive you away from God. And praise be to God, he sends his Holy Spirit to remind us of that and to keep us faithful to him. He comes and he dwells within us. He reminds us of the promises and the instructions of God. He comes and he dwells with us. And think about this. It's because the Holy Spirit is with us forever that we don't have to worry about where we are in the world. We don't have to worry about what's going on in our life. And whether we're in the classroom, the hospital, at our home, in a group of 1,000 people, or by ourselves, we are never alone. Someone who loves us dearly and is for us and has all power at his disposal, God the Holy Spirit, is with us everywhere at every time. And also, here's another wonderful truth with that. If we know that the Holy Spirit is living in us right now, we have every confidence that we will be with God forever. In Scripture, the Holy Spirit is actually described as a guarantee and as a deposit for the blessings to come. Right now, you can know that you are right with God, that He loves you, and that you are going to be with God forever because the Holy Spirit is with you. So you know that when you die, you will not be separated with God. You will be forgiven, and you will live with God forever in His kingdom. And the Holy Spirit's the one who assures us of that because He is dwelling with us at this very moment. Praise be to God for His Holy Spirit who comes and dwells with us. But there's one third and final thing, and perhaps one of the ones that we talk about the most or need to talk about even more. And the Holy Spirit, as He applies the benefits of redemption to us, the Holy Spirit empowers. He applies, He reveals, He indwells, and He empowers. I have to admit, one of my least favorite things in the world to do is to call a company helpline. Why? Because you're on hold forever, and if you're calling about some electronic device, not only do you have to wait for about half an hour to talk to someone, but after you start talking to someone, you have to talk to them about 20 minutes before you can begin addressing the real and actual problem. My computer won't work. Is your computer plugged in? Yes, I understand that an electronic device requires electricity. I have checked that my computer is plugged in. I'm not sure who they have to ask that question for. I don't know who that person is. But yes, electronic devices do require electricity. But I will tell you this, I've met several people who don't realize that they need the Holy Spirit and the power that He brings, because they have forgotten or do not realize that they are spiritual people. They have been built to have a relationship with God and to do spiritual things, and those spiritual things are not possible unless they are connected to a spiritual power source, and that spiritual power source is the Holy Spirit. Without Him, we can do nothing spiritually, or at least you can qualify that and say we can do nothing good spiritually. We can do plenty bad spiritual decisions, but we cannot do good things that actually honor God and strengthen our relationship with Him and bring glory to His name unless His Holy Spirit is in work in us. We need the Holy Spirit's power. We need the Holy Spirit's power to come to faith in Jesus Christ. Did you realize that? We are told in Scripture that no one will profess Jesus Christ as Lord unless the Holy Spirit allows them to do so. Even your salvation, the Holy Spirit had to first empower and work in you to help you realize you needed Jesus Christ and to profess faith in Him. You are regenerated by the Holy Spirit and brought life and empowered before you even had faith in Him. But then the works of the Holy Spirit continues. The Holy Spirit helps us to understand and empowers us to understand God's Word and to act according to it, to follow God's commandments, to love God and to love others. If we are able to do so, it is because the Holy Spirit has given us the power to do so. The Holy Spirit also empowers us to worship God. We are called to worship God in spirit and in truth. How can we glorify God unless the Holy Spirit comes and indwells us and allows us to give God the glory instead of ourselves? It is the Holy Spirit that comes and empowers us with gifts for the church. God has come and sent His Holy Spirit to give us gifts. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 11, gifts that are used to build up and strengthen the church. Now, I will confess here I may have a different opinion upon some people about what gifts are still active in the church today, but there are gifts that are only available by the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is continuing to work and bless His people so that they can strengthen others inside the church. And brothers and sisters, if you haven't heard this before, it is not a matter of whether or not you've been given a gift by the Holy Spirit to build up the church. It is simply a question of whether you recognize and realize you've been given the gift and whether you are using that gift. If you are not using the gift today, it is because you are not following and using the gifts that the Holy Spirit has already given to you. He has given you gifts to build up this church. Are you building up the church and using the gifts of the Holy Spirit to do so? But it is also the Holy Spirit, and I'm getting near the end here, that empowers us to proclaim the gospel. The Holy Spirit is the one who is able to bring the truths to mind and help us to speak those truths to other people so they could hear the gospel message and respond to it. That would not be possible without the Holy Spirit. In fact, Jesus Christ tells the disciples, remember his instructions? Before he tells them to go to the ends of the earth, he tells them to wait in Jerusalem. What were they waiting for? They were awaiting the arrival of the Holy Spirit to come and his power to fall upon him so that they could then be his witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. They needed the Holy Spirit's power to help them proclaim the gospel. And that's exactly what the Holy Spirit does. He enables us to speak the words that others need to hear, to proclaim the gospel. And it's not just in us that the Holy Spirit works. He also works in the minds and hearts of the hearers of the word. Because that is when God, the Holy Spirit, comes in. And he allows them and casts the scales off their eyes and allows them to see the truth, hear the truth, and respond to the truth. Oh, brothers and sisters, our successes and failures, our victories will not be found in proclaiming the gospel if it was not for the Holy Spirit working through us to proclaim it and working in the lives of others to receive it. If the gospel is going to go forward, it must be by the work of God's Holy Spirit. And so, brothers and sisters, go and proclaim the gospel boldly, but do so not in the confidence of yourself, but in the Holy Spirit at work in you and in the lives of others. It is in He in whom your confidence should be found. In fact, Jesus Christ says something amazing to the disciples, something baffling to the disciples if you read it at first. John 14:12, we read it this morning. In that passage of Scripture, Jesus Christ tells the disciples that they are going to do greater works than him. Did you catch that? The disciples are going to do greater works than Jesus Christ. You and I can do greater works than Jesus Christ. How can that be true? I am not the second person of the Trinity. I am not God incarnate. I did not bring the universe into existence. I did not die on the cross for the redemption of all people from their sins. I did not raise myself on the third day. How could I dare think that I could do more greater works than Jesus Christ? I would say when Jesus Christ tells the disciples and us that, he is referring to the work that the Holy Spirit will do in and through us. And what I believe he is telling us is that the church and the kingdom of God that he initiated and brought into existence will grow and flourish to a great extent because it is now the Holy Spirit in work in the world, convicting people of their sins and bringing them to faith in Jesus Christ through the disciples and through us as we proclaim the gospel. Think about it for a minute, and I'm going to end. I promise I'm getting to the end here. But let me tell you this. Think about it. Jesus Christ is roughly 40 years here on earth, 3 years of public ministry. He came, he taught, he performed miracles, he died on the cross and raised himself from the dead. How many people at the end of Jesus' life here on earth had publicly professed Jesus as their Lord and Savior and were counted as one of his disciples and followers? Do you know the answer? Acts actually tells us the answer. Acts chapter 1, verse 15. How many believers and disciples of Jesus Christ were there at the ascension of Jesus Christ? 120. Can you believe that? 120 people. That's it. Peter. Simple Peter. Peter, the denier of Jesus Christ. The Spirit comes upon him. And he preaches one sermon after the Holy Spirit is at work in him and in the world today. And on that day, on Pentecost Sunday, 3,000 people came to faith in Jesus Christ. It is estimated in 180 AD that there were 100,000 believers in the church. And it is estimated today that in the world's population of a little over 7 billion, 2.6 billion people are Christians. How is that possible? It is because the Holy Spirit is at work applying the benefits of salvation to believers, attaching them to Jesus Christ, and bringing them life. And that same Spirit is at work today in the church and in you and me if we have professed faith in Jesus Christ. Go and live and proclaim the gospel boldly in the new life that Jesus Christ brings and is applied to you by the Holy Spirit. Realize the importance and significance of the Holy Spirit and His role in the world and in each of our salvation. Recognize and celebrate and praise the Holy Spirit as God. And continue to look to Him for your strength and for your life and the blessings that He brings to you as He comes and He lives with you. As He comes and He reveals the truth to you. As He comes and empowers you. As He applies the benefits of redemption to you. As the third person of the Trinity. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day and we thank you for this time together. Oh Lord, it is a delight to gather together. And oh Lord, even I must take confidence that I know I probably could have written a better sermon and spent more time studying and gotten things more correctly or more concise or more profound. But oh Lord, I take such comfort to knowing each and every Sunday is not just up to me. Your Holy Spirit is at work, and it is at work in me, and it is at work in the hearts and the minds of those who listen to your word proclaimed. So, Father, we pray that the truths that your Holy Spirit would convey, Lord, would be received by those together today. For those that do not know you as their Lord and Savior, you would reveal the truth that they are sinners and they need Christ to save them from their sins this very day by your Holy Spirit. Apply that truth and reveal it to them. And for those like me that are too quick to trust in our own strength and our own weaknesses and to be discouraged, remind us that we are not on our own. We have a power with us beyond comprehension that is able to do far exceedingly more than we can ever conceive or imagine or expect. Your Holy Spirit lies upon us. Keep us attached to Him. Keep us faithful to Him. And may He use us for your glory, the triune God, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to close with our final hymn at this time, hymn number 372, Living for Jesus. Please stand if able as we sing together hymn 372.
Thank you.
Brothers and sisters, thank you so much for coming and joining us and worshiping our great God today. I hope that the Holy Spirit has been at work in you and you will leave encouraged and you will leave closer to God and being reminded of all the promises that are yours both now and forever because of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Please join us on Wednesday for our first Wednesday cover dish and program. Come and join us for our services next Saturday for Jim Hart at 3 p.m. Come and join us for coffee and cookies after the service. You've earned it. You've been in here a long time. Please come and welcome our brother Ryan and tell him how excited and thankful we are for his fellowship and being a part of our body here at Pinecrest. Find him after the service and take special note. You can also welcome Evan Carson to our staff here at Pinecrest Church on a temporary basis and tell him how much you appreciate him. And go ahead and tell Kathy and Judy as well as you find them after the service too. But now receive the Lord's benediction. Now may the grace, may the mercy, may the peace of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be yours now and forever. Amen.